हरे कृष्णा। हरे कृष्णा। सो वेलकम टू द संडे फीस्ट टुडे। एक्चुअली हू इज सिटिंग डाउन, यू कैन कम अ लिटिल क्लोजर। If it's okay with you. So today we will talk on the significance of Diwali. Yesterday was Diwali and for some today is. But before that we will have a small kirtan. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari, Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari, Jaya Radha. Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivaradhari, Gopi Jana Vallabha. Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivaradhari, Aya Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivaradhari. Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana, Yashoda Nandana Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana, Yashoda Nandana Yamuna Tira Vanachari, Yamuna Tira Vanachari, Yamuna Tira Vanachar. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari, Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare. Mm-hmm. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Jaya Radha Madan Mohan Radha Madan Mohan Radhe Jaya Radha Madan Mohan Jaya Mahaprabhu Jaya Mahaprabhu Jaya Mahaprabhu Jaya Mahaprabhu Jaya Mahaprabhu Jaya Jaya Lakshmi Narasimha, Jaya Lakshmi Narasimha, Lakshmi Narasimha, Jaya Lakshmi Narasimha, Jaya Lakshmi Narasimha. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada. Prabhupada jaya jaya Prabhupada jaya 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 Prabhupada 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 jaya jaya Prabhupada jaya jaya श्रीला प्रभुपाद की जय। सो विल स्टार्ट विद द ऑस्पिशियस इन्वोकेशन प्रेयर्स। विच इज इन द फर्स्ट पेज ऑफ द भगवद्गीता। Anyway, we can all recite it together. I know many of you know it. So, Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurum Nilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dhati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagarjatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Deva Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dhina Bandho Jagatpate Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Rishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyasya Kripa Sindhu Bevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Shri Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama,
Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
So today we'll have a discussion on the significance of Diwali. So how many of you celebrated Diwali yesterday? Was it yesterday? So for some it was yesterday, I think, and for some it's today, right? So, of course, we celebrate Diwali by lighting lamps. That is one of the main activity that we, what other things that we do? Yeah, eating sweets. What is that? Pleasantries. Right, it's a celebration, it's a festival. Of course, that is the on the external level where we actually light lamps and then we greet others with sweets and we also honor prasadam and sweets.
Sing Damodarashtakam.
Yeah, sing Damodarashtakam. Thank you. Thank you. And of course, these are the external formalities that we is the ritual. There is a ritual aspect, but of course there is an internal inner meaning for the significance of Diwali. Especially there is a philosophical meaning, and also there are also significance from the history. So one of the significance from the history is that this is the day when Lord Ram returns to Ayodhya. So, and the residents of Ayodhya actually welcome the Lord by lighting the lamps and expressing their joy, because they have been feeling the pangs of separation from the Lord. It is said that when the Lord left Ayodhya, the city had become lifeless practically, because Lord Ram was the object of their affection and love, and he had attracted all their hearts towards him, but then he left. He was actually exiled for 14 years. I mean, of course, there is so much details as to why Lord Ram left Ayodhya, but then this is the day. Diwali is the day when he actually returns, and then he returns to give joy to his devotees. He returns to give them life, and they celebrated by lighting the lamps. Of course, the philosophical significance behind this is true history from India, and the philosophical significance being that Diwali is the day when we actually request the Lord to enter our hearts. Ayodhya can be considered to be like our heart, and it becomes barren when we ask the Lord to leave or when we exile. Actually, there is the Bhagavad Gita states that the Lord actually never leaves. He actually is there in our heart as a Paramatma, as the super or the supreme soul. So he never leaves, but we have turned away from him. So so we are the living entities, the Jivatma, and then there is the Supreme Soul, the Paramatma, and we have turned our face away from him, due to which you know, our life becomes filled with ignorance. And this is one of the imports of Diwali. By lighting the lamp externally, it also means that we light the lamp internally by inviting the Lord into our heart. And there is also one more significance, which will probably come to that. Of course, we sing the Damodarashtakam the whole month, right? And this is the day Vishnu Acharya Chakravarti Thakur says that Mother Yashoda ties Krishna to the grinding motor. Diwali is the day. And of course, there is so much of significance to that particular pastime from Krishna Leela. And we'll talk about that a little later. But before that, the Diwali is also the day when we can actually, it also signifies good over evil. Light over darkness. And we can honor that by committing ourselves to the spiritual practices. You know, one of my teachers, he talks about this example of a good dog and a bad dog in our heart. So we have both a good dog and a bad dog in our heart. And however we engage, in whatever we invest, we either strengthen the good dog or the bad dog. So depending on whatever activities we engage in, one of these dogs gets strengthened. So it is also a day when we can reaffirm the spiritual activities that we engage in, so that automatically our higher self gets strengthened, so that we can overcome our lower self. So our higher self, meaning, you know, our the attributes that we exhibit with our true identity. What are some of the attributes of the higher self? Can you mention few? You can use the mic.
I would say that the higher self does spiritual activity like hearing, chanting, remembering, worshiping the Lord, offering prayers, offering food, doing deity worship and bathing the deity, worshiping, and reading scripture, and maybe giving charity to the temple or to other devotees, doing voluntary work for the temple.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other points? What are some of the attributes? Swapnil. Humility. Okay.
I think Bhagavad Gita 6th chapter mentions a list of qualities like forgiveness, truthfulness, cleanliness. So those are the attributes.
Very nice. Yeah, there are some qualities which Krishna describes. Because Krishna describes this at many places in the Bhagavad Gita. 16th chapter talks about the divine and demonic qualities. 13th chapter, Krishna talks about the list of items which forms the gateway for knowledge. If you go to 13th chapter, 8th verse, so in 8 to 12, he talks about the list of qualities that Krishna declares as knowledge. Or, you know, it acts as a gateway to knowledge. If you go to the translation, so Krishna talks about, you know, humility, pridelessness, non-violence, tolerance, simplicity, approaching a bona fide spiritual master, cleanliness, steadiness, self-control, renunciation of the objects of sense gratification, absence of false ego, the perception of evil of birth, death, old age and disease, detachment, freedom from entanglement with children, wife, home and the rest, even-mindedness amid pleasant and unpleasant events, constant and unalloyed devotion to me, aspiring to live in a solitary place, retachment from the general mass of people, accepting the importance of self-realization, and philosophical search for the absolute truth. All these I declare to be knowledge. And besides this, whatever there may be is ignorance. Yeah, this is an indication of the higher self, basically, where we actually encompass all these qualities, many of these qualities. Our spiritual self embodies all these different qualities. But of course, our conditioned nature is very different. Our conditioned nature may not exhibit all these qualities. Our conditioned nature may exhibit at times the lower nature, which is lust, greed, anger, envy, etc. So, how do we strengthen our higher nature, our spiritual self? Is there are many ways that she told, you know, by actually committing to our spiritual practices. By actually committing to our spiritual practices, we enable our higher nature to overcome our lower self. So we strengthen our higher nature in that way. So that is also one of the imports of Diwali, is that, you know, by lighting our heart with spiritual wisdom and knowledge, we also drive away the darkness. And Krishna says, refers in the Bhagavad Gita that he lights the lamp in our heart. Anybody know which chapter it is? He lights the lamp of knowledge in our heart. 10th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. So, we'll also look at that, because Diwali signifies the lighting of the lamp in our heart. We can also look at that particular verse. In fact, from 10.8, 10.9, 10.10 and 10.11, it's called Chatursloki Gita. Anybody know the significance of these four verses? Yeah. These four verses, it's actually gives you a nutshell of and an overview of the Bhagavad Gita. It's called Chatursloki Gita. So if you know these four verses very well, it's as equivalent as knowing the whole Bhagavad Gita. The essence, the real essence of the Bhagavad Gita. So the 10.8 actually talks about, we will read it, and then we will just have a quick discussion on the last verse. So here's the Sanskrit. Actually, we can all recite it together. Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante ma bhuda bhava samanvitaha. So Krishna says, I am the source of all the spiritual and material worlds. Everything emanates from me. The wise who perfectly know this engage in my devotional service and worship me with all their hearts. I'll read it again. I am the source of all the spiritual and material worlds. Everything emanates from me. The wise who perfectly know this engage in my devotional service and worship me with all their hearts. So Krishna here is indicating that he is the source of everything, and the person who is actually convinced, has this conviction, he engages in worship of the Supreme and with all their hearts. So what does this verse describe? Right.
Krishna is the supreme absolute truth and nothing is higher than him.
Okay. That's a good point. What else? What comes to your mind when you see this verse?
knowing this, I'm here. Knowing this, the person who knows this is constantly thinking of me, or he's constantly praying to me.
Okay.
It's like sambandha gyan, like we, our connection with the Supreme Lord.
Okay. I mean, all, yeah, all those are, this verse reflects Krishna's opulence or majesty, that he is the source of everything. And of course, when we hear the word Supreme Being or God, what comes to our mind? That he is a controller. He is a proprietor. He is, he is just in control of everything. So all the majestic opulence and all these attributes comes to our mind, and that's exactly what this verse indicates. So this verse talks about how Krishna is the source of everything, and that actually resembles his majesty, his supreme potency. In fact, Arjuna realizes this, then right in the next chapter, Krishna shows his universal form. Because Arjuna asks him, he says here, everything emanates from me, and then he's the source of everything. And then Arjuna asks, how do you pervade the whole universe? And then Krishna shows the universal form, and then shows how he pervades the entire cosmos, and how everything is happening in his direction. So this actually talks about the opulence of Krishna. But the remaining set of verses talks about, of course, it just scratches the sweetness of Krishna. The next three verses talks about how actually Krishna reciprocates with his devotees. At one level, he is the supreme, origin of everything. He's the source of everything, but that doesn't make him impersonal. He is as much as a person, even though he is the source of everything. So Krishna has these contradictory things within him, because he is the supreme being. So the next three verses talks about what does a devotee do? What does a transcendentalist do? One who is convinced of Krishna's place and his opulence, and then how Krishna reciprocates with them. The next three verses talk about that. So that talks about Krishna. It just indicates Krishna's sweetness. So we'll read that together. It's 10.9. Machitta madgata prana bodhayanta parasparam katayantascha mam nityam tusyanti cha ramanti cha. So the translation: the thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. Their lives are fully devoted to my service, and they derive great satisfaction and bliss from always enlightening one another and conversing about me. So this is how a devotee or a transcendentalist act, having the factual knowledge that Krishna is the source of everything. What does he do? He just dedicates his whole life in trying to re-establish the connection with the Supreme Lord. And how does he do it? He does it by always thinking about Krishna and engaging in his devotional service and always conversing about him or his message, or reading the Bhagavad Gita or the Bhagavatam, and engrossed in the pastimes, activities, instruction, and chanting the holy names of Krishna like that. So the devotee actually constantly remembers Krishna in this way. And of course, Srila Prabhupada, he very nicely describes the whole process of devotional service in that purport. He talks about how one is fortunate enough to actually... let's read the purport. So we can actually take turns and read probably one paragraph from the purport. Maybe, Shyamala Prabhu, you want to read?
Pure devotees whose characteristics are mentioned here engage themselves fully in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. Their minds cannot be diverted from the lotus feet of Krishna. Their talks are solely on the transcendental subjects. The symptoms of the pure devotees are described in this verse specifically. Devotees of the Supreme Lord are 24 hours daily engaged in glorifying the qualities and pastimes of the Supreme Lord. Their hearts and souls are constantly submerged in Krishna, and they take pleasure in discussing Him with other devotees.
In the preliminary stage of devotional service, they release the transcendental pleasure from the service itself. And in the mature stage, they are actually situated in love of God.
We'll just take a... Isn't that an interesting statement? In the preliminary stage of devotional service, they release the transcendental pleasure from the service itself. That's true, right? So initially, when we come into the process, we get more connected to the service than because you know it because we are in a condition stage, the service becomes our connection to Krishna, and then we relish doing that service, is it not? Like, you know, there are so many different services that we do, either it's book distribution or preaching, and that service becomes our big connection, like making garlands or doing deity worship or so each of us are different, and we we actually relish one or another kind of service. Like some devotees actually relish kirtans, some devotees relish just doing some menial service, you know, like cooking or, you know, and worshipping the deity. So each of us, we have a particular nature, and a particular service appeals to us, and we get attached to that service. And that connection is very important. And that's what Srila Prabhupada is mentioning here, that initially, you know, we get pleasure from the service. It's the service actually which gives us the connection to Krishna. That is that service which reminds us of Krishna. And, of course, chanting is also a service. Chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is also a service. So we have to find our unique... We have a nature, and when we find our... a service which is actually in harmony with our nature, then it becomes a great combination. And when we hold on tight to that service will help us to come to the stage of being situated in love of Krishna. So that is a different state. Where we right now we do things because we like that, but then it also is service of Krishna, so it purifies our heart. But then there will be a stage when we do things out of love of Krishna. So that is a very mature stage. That's what Srila Prabhupada is talking about here. Go ahead.
Once situated in that transcendental position, they can release the highest perfection which is exhibited by the Lord in His abode. Lord Chaitanya likens transcendental devotional service to the sowing of a seed in the heart of the living entity. There are innumerable living entities traveling throughout the different planets of the universe, and out of them there are few
who are fortunate enough to meet a pure devotee and get the chance to understand devotional service. This devotional service is just like a seed, and if it is sown in the heart of a living entity, and if he goes on hearing and chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, that seed fructifies just as the seed of a tree fructifies with regular watering.
So we'll, yeah. So this devotional service is like a seed. Of course, this is all from Chaitanya Charitamrita. This is actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instructions. As Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was discussing the science of devotional service to Rupa Goswami, he actually mentions all these points, and Prabhupada summarizes all these points in this particular purport. So it starts off from this verse, Brahmande Brahmate Kaun Bhagyavan Jeevan Guru Krishna Prasadevaya Bhakti Lata Beej. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling that Rupa Goswami, who is that fortunate person actually, that who receives the seed of bhakti, who receives the seed of devotion from a pure devotee. So the other point is that that bhakti only comes from bhakti. Bhakti doesn't come from any other aspect or activity. So one can be pious, one can engage in a lot of pious activity, one can engage in a lot of karmakanda activities, one can cultivate a lot of knowledge. But ultimately, that only makes one's heart favorable. Piety actually only makes one's heart favorable. But what is that gives rise to devotion? It's none of these things. It's actually another devotee, and especially a pure devotee. So when one associates with a pure devotee, then he, by his favorable contact, one gets the seed of bhakti into one's heart. And when one has the discipline and the good spiritual background, or good pious background, then it creates a favorable fertile ground for the seed to be put in. And once the seed of one receives the seed of bhakti by coming in contact with a spiritual, a bhakti yoga practitioner, then one actually takes care of that seed and plant by doing the spiritual practices that is recommended. By engaging in the spiritual practices, then that seed fructifies and then it grows into a tree, and then it actually grows into a big plant, and then so on and so forth. So this in that particular chapter, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu talks about how one has to do this watering frequently, because if the watering is stopped, then the seed actually withers away or dies. And of course, he also talks about how along with this seed, one has, because of one's conditioned nature, there is also the object of, so when the object of our love, our affection is Krishna, then the bhakti creeper grows very nicely. But then we have other object of affection in this world. Because of our conditioned nature, we have many other object of affection. It could be money, it could be this, that, it could be the material glitter that we are conditioned to. So when we have the, so all those are also there as seeds, or sometimes are big trees actually in our heart. So when we chant Hare Krishna without, so we should chant Hare Krishna with the right motive. So what is chanting Hare Krishna means? Of course, it's mantra meditation. Chanting Hare Krishna means, Krishna, I love you. I want to make you as the object of my affection. as the sole object of my affection. So that is what chanting Hare Krishna means. And that should be our mood also when we chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. But when we chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, you know, going after so many other objects, then what happens is we are actually watering the weeds. We are not watering the... we are actually watering the weeds instead of watering the Bhakti Lata Beej. So that's why Bhaktivinoda Thakur says that there are 10 offenses to the holy name, but the root of all offenses, inattentive chanting. From inattentive chanting, all the other offenses actually comes forth. So one has to be very careful when chanting Hare Krishna, that one has to perform it properly. It's a meditation, so one has to try to focus. In fact, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that even if one endeavors, so there are different levels of chanting. You know, in fact, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says there are three obstacles, main obstacles to attentive chanting, which is, the three main obstacles are, anybody knows? Yeah, go ahead.
Hridaya Dorbalyam, weakness of the heart?
Yeah, I mean, there are three obstacles. I mean, what you're talking about, the causes, which are into five categories actually. But the three main causes for inattentive chanting is laziness, distraction, indifference. So these are the three. So it's laziness, distraction, and indifference. So these are the three reasons why one does inattentive chanting. Of course, laziness, we know, we don't have to. And then the second point is indifference. So when distraction. So distraction. This is because we, when we don't understand the, when we don't set, what do they call that? Purpose. There is a Sanskrit word I am looking for actually. Yeah, there is a purpose and a focus. In Sanskrit it's called, anyway, I'm forgetting the word. But when we don't keep the focus, or when we don't have the determination, actually, when we don't set the determination before doing that particular activity as why I'm doing this activity and what is the reason for me to do this activity, then what happens? It becomes goalless. And then wherever the mind wavers, one actually goes behind the mind. And then the mind is expert actually in distracting us, in creating a dialogue and engaging us, you know. And so whenever we sit to chant, you know, it's just unbelievable how many thoughts just come out, and then we engage dwelling on the thoughts, you know. Oh, suddenly a thought, just sitting and chanting, okay, what I'm going to have for lunch. Is it not that just one thought that just comes out? And then you dwell on it actually. Oh, okay, let me have chapati and... and then there is a whole planning going on, and then the mouth is actually chanting Hare Krishna and doing the meditation. But then the mind is focusing on all different, you know, planning for the day and how I'm going to tackle that person at work. And there's this whole... you know, whole level of, thinking going on internally. In fact, Hanumat Preksha Swami, he jokes that when if one's chanting is at that level, then one's mouth will go back home back to Godhead. the person will remind actually. So one's chanting should be heart deep, not just mouth deep. And sankalpa, it's called sankalpa. So one has to have a sankalpa before entering the process. The sankalpa means it's forming a determination. Okay, I will, you know, do attentive mantra meditation. I will do attentive chanting. Because it's not, one thing is, if you don't do attentive chanting, we are not going to get the desired object of love for Krishna. But the thing is, it has negative consequences as well. It's not only that by inattentive chanting, one loses, you know, connecting with Krishna in a strong manner. One also waters the weeds. So that's why it has to be done very carefully. Chanting of the Hare. Chanting process is a serious process. One has to do it very, take it seriously. It's like fire. That's why they say that spiritual life is like a razor's edge. So one has to do it very, very carefully. To have the desired effect. Yes, bro.
Then in that case, bro, what if someone gets this doubt that, oh, maybe it's better if I stop chanting rather than chanting inattentively? So,
well, that's why we have the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Because Mahaprabhu says that if one just endeavors to do attentive chanting, one may not be capable, or one may not have the strength, or yoga balena, and one may not have the capacity to focus, you know, attentively for a long time. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, even if one endeavors, even if one has the desire, then I accept it. So, what we need to have is the right intention. I mean, many times we just very casually, you know, we switch on the TV or we look at a newspaper and then we just chant Hare, you know, the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, and so that has to be avoided. So one has to, so that is offensive chanting. So one has to deliberate. That at least try or have the endeavor that I have to do it in a focused manner. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that's good. You know, for me that's good enough. So one can attain the mercy. Ultimately, by having Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy, we can chant the pure holy name. So without his mercy, you know, it's because of his mercy we are chanting in the first place. Because this is a process that pure devotees do. Which is singing constantly, chanting his holy name, being attentive to, you know, his pastime instructions. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has given us this freely, and by his mercy we'll be able to also chant his holy name. But the endeavor should be there, that one should chant in a focused manner. We'll read the rest of the purport, and then we'll go to the next few verses.
The spiritual plant of devotional service gradually grows and grows until it penetrates the covering of the material universe and enters into the Brahma Jyoti effulgence in the spiritual sky. In the spiritual sky also, that plant grows more and more until it reaches the highest planet, which is called Golok Vrindavan, the supreme planet of Krishna. Ultimately, the plant takes shelter at the lotus feet of Krishna and rests there. Gradually, as a plant grows, fruits and flowers, that plant of devotional service also produces fruits, and the watering process in the form of chanting and hearing goes on. This plant of devotional service is fully described in the Chaitanya Charitamrita Muddha Lila, chapter 19. It is explained there that when the complete plant takes shelter under the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, one becomes fully absorbed in love of God, then he cannot live even for a moment without being in contact with the Supreme Lord, just as a fish cannot live without water. In such a state, the devotee actually attains the transcendental qualities in contact with the Supreme Lord.
You can go ahead.
The Srimad Bhagavatam is also full of such narrations about the relationship between the Supreme Lord and his devotees. Therefore, the Srimad Bhagavatam is very dear to the devotees, as stated in the Bhagavatam itself, 12, 13, 18. Srimad Bhagavatam Puranam Amalang Jad Vaishnavanang Priyam. In this narration, there is nothing about material activities, economic development, sense gratification, or liberation. Srimad Bhagavatam is the only narration in which the transcendental nature of the Supreme Lord and his devotees is fully described. Thus, the realized souls in Krishna consciousness take continual pleasure in hearing such transcendental literatures, just as a young boy and girl take pleasure in association.
All right. Yeah. So basically, Prabhupada, the end talks about how this watering process helps in the growth of the Bhaktilata Beej, and ultimately it takes shelter at the lotus feet of Krishna. And it also talks about the Srimad Bhagavatam, how that is also a watering process, part of the watering process. So there are, out of the 64 devotional items, the 5 devotional items are very, very important. They are chanting, reading Srimad Bhagavatam. What is that? Residing in a holy place, worshipping the deity. Yeah, serving and associating with the devotees. So these are 5, you can actually, you can remember it as A, B, C, D. A stands for association. Of course, there's one more. B stands for books. Books, reading books. Especially Srimad Bhagavatam and the Bhagavad Gita. C stands for chanting. And D stands for deity worship. And of course, there is also the place of the holy place, Hedge. So, these 4 things, you know, A stands for, so spiritually like-minded people, if you associate, one gets the determination. One gets the determination to follow the, you know, the path of spirituality, to hang on in the pursuit of spirituality. And B stands for these books, the spiritual literatures, the spiritual books. Again, one fortifies one's intelligence. It fortifies one's intelligence to actually follow in the path of spirituality. Because intelligence has to be fortified. If intelligence is fortified, what does intelligence control? The mind. The mind and the senses. So intelligence controls the mind and the senses. So when intelligence is fortified, automatically the mind and the senses fall in place. So the intelligence has to be fortified. And then, we also have to have an activity which we can focus on or absorb ourselves on, and this is the chanting of the holy names of the Lord. So when the mind absorbs or focuses in the chanting of the holy names of the Lord, then it's direct association with Krishna, because the holy name of Krishna is non-different than Krishna himself. It's direct of association of Krishna, and it purifies our mind. So mantra, you know, mantra itself means man and tra. You know, man means the mind, and tra means to uplift or to deliver. So it raises our level of consciousness when we engage ourselves in the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. In fact, Vaisheshika Prabhu says that he says there are 3 things that comes out of as a result of proper mantra meditation or chanting. That is, discipline. One becomes disciplined. We all want to be disciplined, right? So one becomes disciplined, and then one feels contented. this contentment. And one, it also raises one's perspective. So the three effects, of course there are many, many effects of chanting of the holy name, but primarily one's perspective increases, one becomes more disciplined, and there is contentment in heart. So, and then deity worship actually. So we can come to the temple and sing and cry and pray to the deity, and then the deity reciprocates. Krishna reciprocates directly. Anyway, these are the five important processes. Now let's go to the next verse, 10:10. So the first two verses were how Krishna is the supreme and how devotee engages himself in the service of the Lord. The next two verses of how Krishna reciprocates to such devotees, such people who are so dependent and dedicated to him and his service, how he reciprocates. So tesham satati yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayanti te. To those who are constantly devoted to serving me with love, I give the understanding by which they can come to me. No, we will actually, we are running out of time. So we'll go to the next verse, 10:11. Tesham evanu kampartham aham agyana jantamaha nashayami atma bhavosto jnana deepena bhashvata. The translation: to show them special mercy, I, dwelling in their hearts, destroy with shining lamp of knowledge the darkness born of ignorance. So these two verses actually describes about Krishna's, the Supreme Lord's, reciprocation to his devoted. So he basically lights the shining lamp of knowledge in our hearts, which destroys the darkness born of ignorance. So Krishna illuminates our heart because he is so pleased with one's dedication of one's time to him, that he illuminates one's heart with sufficient transcendental knowledge and enlightens one so that they can actually continue the path, the spiritual path. So this is Krishna's personal, he's a friend in our heart and he personally reciprocates like that. And this is another significance of Diwali, which is that when we invest our time in Krishna consciousness on the path of bhakti, then Krishna lights the lamp of knowledge. So we light the lamp outside, and Krishna, when we invite Krishna into our heart, then Krishna lights the lamp of knowledge within our heart. And then the third point, which we'll very quickly talk about, is the pastime of the Damodar Leela, where the Supreme Lord actually gets tied to a grinding motor. So that Damodar Leela happens the same day of Diwali. And of course the pastime is the pastime is such that all of you know the pastime. Krishna is Mother Yashoda, this is in the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, 9th chapter. Mother Yashoda is churning the curd so that she can actually make butter. At the time, Krishna actually comes and to increase the love of his devotees, and especially his mother, he actually performs this particular pastime, where he actually comes as hungry, and then Mother Yashoda takes him on her lap and then feeds him. But in between, she hears the milk boiling in the kitchen. So what she does, she actually puts Krishna down and then goes and attends to the milk boiling. So Krishna becomes angry at this, because he is enjoying the parental affection with his mother, and suddenly there is an abrupt, of course it's all part of the Leela, so abruptly, you know, it stopped because Mother Yashoda puts him down and then she goes and takes care of other things. So Krishna becomes angry, and then what he does, he goes and breaks all the pot that's, you know, all the pots that has butter that his mother has created. And not only does he do that, he actually invites all the monkeys and he actually shares all the butter to them. And it is said, the Acharya's comment, that actually the monkeys are from the previous yuga. They are actually the vanaras of who helped Lord Rama in his victory and fight with Ravana. So Krishna, of course, he is the same Supreme Lord. He wanted to reciprocate with them, you know. And the one way he was reciprocating with them is sharing the butter with them. And then Mother Yashoda sees the pots are broken everywhere, and the butter is just thrown at all the places. And then she sees the footprint, you know, going here and there, the butter footprint actually. And then so she sneaks behind Krishna, and then so slowly goes behind to catch him. Now Mother Yashoda wants to discipline him. So this is the beauty of that pastime. You know, just before this chapter, Krishna opens his mouth, because his brother Balaram, he complains that Krishna has eaten dirt. So Mother Yashoda asks Krishna to open his mouth. And Krishna opens his mouth, what does she see? She sees the whole cosmos, the whole entire, you know, manifestation of cosmos inside his mouth. And she sees herself also inside his mouth. But then she is standing outside. So this is the mystic potency of the Supreme Lord. I mean, you know, he's same time inside and also outside. Anyway, this just happened, just recently, I mean, sometime back, before the Damodar Leela happened. But the beauty of this pastime is that, so Mother Yashoda now runs, so Krishna sees that his mother is behind him, so he runs. And then he runs out of fear actually. And Mother Yashoda is chasing him. And Queen Kunti prays in the Bhagavatam, this is very bewildering actually. Because the fear personified is afraid of the Supreme Lord, but then he is actually running out of fear of his mother. And this is very, very bewildering to me. And so Mother Yashoda is running and running, and Krishna is very quick. But Mother Yashoda, you know, she is, because of an elderly gopi, she is a little slow to catch up to Krishna. But finally, she actually catches hold of Krishna. So there is a beautiful purport which says that the yogis, the mystics, the jnanis, the karmis, you know, and all kinds of people, they actually try to conquer the Supreme Lord. But none of the Supreme Lord is beyond the reach of their endeavors. He doesn't come within the clutches of all these different practitioners. But how is that he actually, great meditators and mystics and all these people actually are running after Krishna, trying to conquer him or catch him. But how is that the Mother Yashoda just Gautam. I mean, she's just a simple, in comparison, she's of course, she's an eternal devotee. This is a simple village lady. How is that? Then Acharya has explained that is because of the devotion. So love of the Supreme conquers, so love, the pure devotional love conquers the Supreme Lord. So that is one of the lessons from this pastime, that the unconquerable becomes caught by pure devotional love. And not only does she catches him, she also binds Krishna to the grinding motor. She also binds Krishna to the grinding motor. And of course, there is also another lesson in that. So she tries to bind Krishna. Of course, Krishna is tiny form actually. He's a tiny little boy. So every time she tries to bind Krishna, it's always 2 inches. The rope is always short. 2 inches too short. So there is also significance in that pastime that there is endeavor, but endeavor alone doesn't mean that one will succeed. There has to be mercy. So she gathers all the ropes in the villages, and then she tries to tie Krishna, but still she is not able to tie because the ropes fall short. And the ropes, so she has miles and miles of ropes, but still the ropes fall short actually. So significance of this pastime is, but ultimately Krishna allows her to bind himself to the grinding motor. The significance of that pastime is that our endeavor is there, but then the 2 inches too short is Krishna's mercy. So when Krishna's mercy is there, so our endeavor is there to attain him, but then there has to also be Krishna's mercy. If there is no endeavor, there is nothing that can happen. But only endeavor also is not enough. There has to be Krishna's mercy as well. So let me just... Yeah, this is another point. So when sweetness supersedes greatness, love conquers the beloved. You know, I'll just read few statements because I found it very enlightening from the BTG magazine. So the article says that God is both great and sweet. Awareness of his greatness evokes submission, whereas awareness of his sweetness evokes affection. Devotee seekers need to be aware of both features, for submission and affection symbiotically reinforce devotion. So for exalted devotees such as Yashoda, however, their awareness of Krishna's greatness is almost entirely eclipsed by their absorption in his sweetness. Yashoda is concerned not about how great Krishna is, but about how greatly he depends on her. Beautiful point, right? There is greatness and sweetness, both the aspect of the absolute truth. So one can, the greatness invokes submission. That is the stage we are in. So we want, that's what the initial 9 cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam does. It talks about the greatness of the Supreme Lord. And that invokes submission. So that is very important. And then comes, there is also another aspect which is sweetness. So that endears us to the Supreme Lord. And both are necessary for our growth. Anyway, so these are some of the points I had with regards to the significance of Diwali. What time is Aarti? Is it at 5:30? Okay. Anyway, so these are some of the points. Any reflections, any thoughts, any comments that you had so far? Yeah, go ahead. Can you speak on the mic?
I had some discussions. One, I'm just asking you, see if you what your opinion is on this with some Christian friends, you know, my co-workers, and they are of the opinion that it's entirely mercy. You know, they say you cannot do anything. It's just all, you know, Jesus Christ's favor on you. And so I told him, I was trying to explain to him, actually both things are required. If you say it's only mercy and that there's no endeavor on your part, then you can do almost any nonsense and say, you know, I'm a failure. So right. Both things have to be there. Right, why is it that they think like that?
No, because there is no emphasis on the practice. Because it's a very, it's half-baked knowledge. Basically that, you know, you can do whatever you want and then you'll be delivered. I mean, that's not making one accountable and responsible. So when that is the prevalent knowledge, then people get misled. Then one doesn't feel any transformation inside. They just, it's just dogmatic faith. There's no transformation inside, unfortunately. Because if one doesn't apply oneself well to the spiritual practices, there's no transformation of heart.
Yeah, he was actually trying to blame me. He was saying, oh, you guys are after works. Whereas in Christianity, we don't care for works. It's only, you know, mercy.
Right. So those are two extremes where one, you know, one thinks that everything depends on one endeavor, that is atheism. And then the other extreme is when one thinks that everything is just mercy, I don't have to take responsibility or accountability, that is also, you know, escaping one's, you know. So Krishna has given us the free will and He also given us the knowledge and He expects us to use it wisely. So we have to use our free will wisely and we also have to be accountable and responsible.
I wanted to comment about Christianity. You can only address Christian things from the Bible with other biblical quotes. And there's another biblical quote that says, not everyone shall enter the kingdom of God who takes the Lord's name, but thou that doth the Lord's will. So it's not just names. Just by calling the names over and over, that's not going to help. You have to do the will of the Lord too. So you can address Christian issues with other Christian, you know, biblical quotes.
Thank you. Damodar Vamsi Prabhu probably had a comment there.
Not a comment, actually, but just wanted to wish all happy Diwali. And then here, Pujaris have offered this Lakshmi coin, silver coins. And tomorrow is Govardhan Puja, which is very dear to all Vaishnavas. You know, we assemble together for the Lord. So anybody who wants to get these coins, please see us. They come for very small price, $150. These are pure silver coins offered to the Lord. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other? Yeah. Someone has a point.
And a very important point regarding Bible is the first thing from a practice standpoint in Bible, they say, the Ten Commandments. If you look at those Ten Commandments, they are really very strict commandments, that thou shall not steal and thou shall not kill. And so there is an element of practice in Christianity. It's just that, and Srila Prabhupada used to, in many of his morning walks and conversations, right, used to stress this point again and again, that these guys who call themselves Christians are not really Christians, basically. Because if they were Christians, then they would have followed all the Ten Commandments.
All right. Thank you.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, thank you very much for the nice class. I liked the 3 points that you mentioned, which Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, which leads to inattentive chanting, laziness, indifference, and distraction.
Thank you. Kuladeep Prabhu wanted to.
Hare Krishna Babu, thanks for your nice class. So regarding, actually I just want to add 1 point about Radha Krishna Prabhu's question. So in different Vaishnava Sampradaya, there is different truth, tatya, nyay. So in some Vaishnava Sampradaya, they believe in complete mercy. Yeah. And that is called marjar nyay, like the law of cat. So the kitten is being carried by the mother cat. So it completely depends on the mother cat. Mm. And in some Vaishnava Sampradaya, there is tatya nyay, like markat nyay, where the calf or the child monkey, it, you know, holds the mother all the time. Mm. So when it jumps from one tree to another tree, it depends on its own will. It just clutches its mother by its own, you know, volition. So similarly, so in Vaishnava Sampradaya, they have this philosophy, but our philosophy is both. Like, we also do our service, we clutches this process, and also we depend on the mercy of the Lord. So both together, this Markat Nyay and Marjan Nyay are, you know, merged together in our Sampradaya that I just wanted to mention.
Right. And the fact also that when the cat actually takes the kitten doesn't struggle. Or the kitten doesn't say, you know, why do you have to carry me? You know, I can take care of myself. So, I mean, because just extending an example, because that is the principle of surrender, is when because this is it's an interesting point, because Krishna says, bewildered by false ego, one thinks himself to be the doer of all activities, which means that he thinks himself to be the cause of the activities and the producer of the result, and then one feels that he can enjoy the result which comes from that. And this is the influence of false ego. So what false ego does is, it prevents us from, when Krishna comes to help us, many times we shrug that, you know, helping hand. And this is very subtle, but especially when we are chanting in the mood of, you know, being the great of the greatest, then we are essentially telling Krishna, you are there, I am there, you know, I am good here. But so when chanting Hare Krishna means inviting Krishna to actually take control of our life, which actually comes from humility and pridelessness, and it comes from a little bit of helplessness as well. Of course, that helplessness can also be intellectually understood. The helplessness can also be intellectually understood, because one has to go through the cycle of birth and death, which is beyond one's capacity to overcome. So there has to be the mood of dependence or humility, and especially when the mother kitten takes, you know, the mother takes the kitten doesn't resist. But when we influenced by false ego, many times we resist. And we don't allow Krishna's blessing or mercy to just enter our lives just like that. And it's an attitude. It's an attitude. Yeah, Prabhu, you had something. That's why Queen Kunti prays that one who is materially exhausted, he can take to your names feelingly. Janmaishwara Sutra Sri Bir, He the Man, Madha Puman. What is the third line? Naiva Harti, Kartumbai, Tuam Achintana Gocharam. Right. So Queen Kunti prays that one cannot just like that chanting, because let's say you have, you know, great parentage or great opulence or rich fame, glory, you know, what is the need for me to take shelter? There's no need for me to take shelter. But one should still take shelter of the Supreme Lord, because He is the greatest of the greatest. Then one can chant with feelings.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Prabhu, I really like the quote you, the sentence you quoted from Back to Godhead about God is both great and sweet. His greatness invokes submission and His sweetness invokes affection. So I felt both aspects are very important. Right. To give to not focus on His greatness and just go for the sweetness may lead to something like sahajiya mentality.
Exactly.
And
very nice
to
point.
Just focus on greatness will make us like, it will be a dry relationship. There won't be reciprocation. It will
right.
be approaching just on the platform of fear, fearing God, as many paths do. So,
very nice point. Thank you. Right. Yeah, Krishna has this wonderful aspect where he is both powerful and approachable. He is both great and sweet. Any other so maybe we can sing a small kirtan before we get ready for the aarti. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Rama Rama Hare 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 Krishna Hare Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Ram Rama Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare
We'll sing another bhajan, short bhajan. So until they quickly set it up. Also, if you can all move a little bit in the front so that the people in the back can actually, there are some people who are standing. So they will get some space to sit down.
Mataji, actually two mics are
Thank you.
Audience.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare
Rama Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna
So we'll sing the Damodar Ashtakam now, which is offering of eight set of verses glorifying the Damodar Leela when Krishna performed.